morning.
Good morning.
How's everyone doing?
Good.
Glad to be here this morning. Sorry I missed last Sunday. A little case of the bronchitis, but it is good to be back in the house of worship this morning. Welcome to the visitors that we have this morning. It is especially good to have you here. Just a few announcements. Everyone is invited to the Victory Dinner today, immediately following this worship service. It is free of charge. And during that dinner, we will recognize our high school seniors during the meal. So we hope you'll join us for that. Please know there will be an important meeting of families with children and youth today here in the sanctuary, immediately following that Victory Dinner and senior recognition. And then this Thursday at 6:30, our Disciples Women will host their annual salad banquet. And I hear that there's going to be entertainment like Johnny Cash, Neil Diamond, Patsy Cline. So that'll be fun. Bring a salad and a box of cereal for our food pantry. And all are welcome, not just the women, the men too. And I'm sure they'll let the kids come too. So hopefully you'll be there for that on Thursday at 6:30. Rob Roebuck, are you in here? There he is. My eyes aren't what they used to be. As Rob comes up to speak to you, please know that in the next song, as we stand and sing after Rob the hymn of praise, that it will be the time where you come up and bring your commitment cards to the church in that box right there. But here's Rob Roebuck.
I just wanted to take a moment and share with you a story that happened to me many, many years ago regarding stewardship. And when we come to this time of year, every year, I hearken back to this time that I had such a tremendous opportunity to be led and to learn. So imagine, if you can, and this may be hard, especially for young people like Ryan Ruff, but imagine that I was in my mid-20s, so I was younger and had more hair, and I'd like to tell you better looking, but that would be a stretch. But I had just started my career, and financially really wasn't making a lot of money, but it was a lot of money for me, and I had very, very meager expenses at the time, and was able to save some money. And so I had this savings, and I knew there was something I needed to do with it. And being a accounting finance guy, I knew that if you took a little bit of money and saved it over a long time, your investments would grow. So this person who's near and dear to me and a friend of mine, a very good financial person, good with money, and had been an active investor, older and wiser than me, I went and thought, well, this is my opportunity to learn. And I said, I have some money saved up, and I have, and I would like to invest it. Can you give me some advice on where and how I can invest it? And I waited with much anticipation and had hoped to take notes and think through how I handled this wealth of knowledge I was going to gain. And I was presented with a question. And it is a question that stuck with me for to this day, and one that I learned a great deal of, but it wasn't a learning on investment. And the question was, are you tithing? Are you giving to your church? Because that's the first place to start. And so, as we come to this time annually in our stewardship, it is my prayer that my acts of stewardship and that our acts of stewardship, that we will look to ourselves and give of our first fruits and our best gifts. And so, as we come to this end of our stewardship campaign, I pray that we will each give of our best and give of our first.
Please turn in your hymnal to our hymn of praise, number 173. Let's stand together as we sing verses 1, 2, and 5 of Christ is Alive.
Christ is alive.
Please be seated.
God tells us, I love those who love me, and those who seek me find me. Would you join together with me in prayer, please? Heavenly Father, we do love you and seek your presence this morning. We ask that you fill our souls with your love and peace as we worship your holy name. Amen.
I've been hearing lots of oldies but goodies recently coming and listening to some of our hymns, and this is no exception. Our hymn of devotion, number 469. Can you turn the mic down, please, a little bit? There's too much feedback coming here. Thank you. The hymn of devotion is number 469. Let's sing verses 1, 2, and 4 of Revive Us Again.
Corinthians 9 says this, whoever sows sparingly will also reap sparingly, and whoever sows bountifully will also reap bountifully. Each one must give as they have decided in their heart, not reluctantly or under compulsion, for God loves a cheerful giver. May we worship God now through the giving of our tithes and offerings. Let us pray. Holy God, may we always respond to your tremendous love with glad and generous hearts. We dedicate these tithes and offerings now in the name of Jesus Christ, who is Lord of all. Amen.
Thank you.
seated. I think one of the most well-known verses in the Bible, and you could probably guess, John 3:16. And that starts off, "For God so loved the world that he gave his only son." God's good at giving, and we're good at receiving. We receive God's love, God's grace, God's patience, God's forgiveness, and the list goes on. But in being a follower of Christ, we're also called to give. Yesterday's Commitment Sunday, and we're called to give financially. But we're also called to give others love, grace, forgiveness, and patience. It's part of who we are by accepting the name Little Christ, Christians. We're called to be like Christ. As we come to the table, we now remember God's love and his sacrifice for all because he gave. But as we prepare, ask yourself, am I giving everything to others as God has given to me? Let us prepare our hearts and minds now for communion.
Our hymn of preparation is number 376. We'll sing verses 1 and 3 if we meet within this holy place.
Let us pray. Lord, we come to you in humility. We just pray for your grace and your love. Please help us to never take this communion symbol for granted. We know that it's a symbol of the greatest gift ever given. And it's a symbol that each week we are able to re-verify and just pray for your Holy Spirit to touch us and to strengthen us through this act. And Lord, we know that in the upper room, your Son told his disciples that these symbols stand for his very life laid down for us, the bread for his body and the wine, the juice for his very blood. We just give you the glory for this gift as we partake today. Please bless us, please strengthen us, please forgive us. We ask all of this in Jesus' name. Amen.
as Jesus got with his disciples during their final meal together. He blessed and broke bread and said, "This is my body, which is given for you. Eat this in remembrance of me." Then he took the cup and he said, "This is my blood of the covenant poured out for the forgiveness of sin. Whenever you drink it, remember me." And each Lord's Day, as we eat of the bread and we sip of the cup, we proclaim the Lord's death until he comes.
Look out now, I might just start coughing and join you all here in a second. If anybody's got any Claritin D, just spread it out. Maybe we should just put it in the communion plate this morning. Too bad we don't have a pharmacist sitting almost all the way back on this other side. I won't mention her name's Davenport, but anyway. As we go to God in prayer this morning, a few that I want to lift up. Debbie Roselle, who has surgery on Monday. Bob Schott, surgery on Wednesday. Julie Wolf on her foot on Thursday. Remember Carolyn Dockery, who has been in the hospital, is at home, as she just continues on her road to recovery. Jane Ketcher, who was at UAMS getting an antibiotic IV drip this morning. And I'm sure there are others. Our children, our youth, parents, grandparents, our church. Would you remember? Would you lift up? Would you pray for? Join me in prayer this morning. O God, from your word we read, "Teach me, O Lord, the way. Give me understanding that I may keep. Lead me in your path. Turn my heart to you. Turn my eyes. Give me life." Oh God, your word is never truer than it is when we read it fresh each new time. For we may have read it and read it and read it and read it, but each time give us fresh eyes, a fresh heart, and a fresh mind as we hear from you through your words in your Bible, in your book. Thank you for this book of truth and life. This book that speaks to our hearts and speaks to our minds and speaks to our souls, guides our spirits, and takes us by the hand as we are led and as we learn. Oh God, this morning we lift up many in our congregation who this week will be having surgery and procedures, some who already have that are now at home, some who continue to struggle with illness. God, I pray for protection for hearts, minds, and spirits, for calm and peace, for understanding, for compassion. I pray for us as a church family. And oh God, I use that word family on purpose. For in as much as we belong to you, we belong to each other. And as a people who belong to you and who belong to each other, ours is the joy. Ours is the heartache, but ours is the opportunity to walk together. So this morning, we walk. one hand being held by you and another reaching out to someone else. Hold our hands. Hold our hearts as we hold on to you and to each other. You have heard our prayer. Now hear the prayer that your Son gave us when he said, "Our Father who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and power, and the glory forever."
My source of strength, my source of hope.
Thank you, choir, and thank you, Mike White, for filling in for Logan. Amen. Good to have you back in the choir loft. I'll take a little more because I don't want to have to talk so loud. Holly, thank you. Do you ever wonder which version of the Bible is the one you should use for any given lesson? I do it every week. I don't know how many different versions I have in my office, but I've got a lot of them. And I look at them a lot. And then I open some of them up every once in a while. Oh, come on, that was supposed to have been really good, you all. Today I'm going to read from the NIV, and there's some difference in setting the tone of where this lady's from or giving just exactly that direction. And there's a little difference today, but today as I read, I'd love you to just think through the story that's being told. Think through the story with me. As someone took the time to write it down and share the story with you, it must be important for us to hear. From Mark, the 7th chapter, I start at the 24th verse. From there he set out and went away to the region of Tyre. He entered a house and didn't want anyone to know he was there. Yet he couldn't escape notice. But a woman whose little daughter had an unclean spirit immediately heard about him, and she came and bowed at his feet. Now the woman was a Gentile, and she begged him to cast the demon out of her daughter. And he said to her, "Let the children be led first, for it's not fair to take the child's food and throw it to the dogs." But she answered him, "Sir, even the dogs underneath the table eat the children's crumbs." Then he said to her, "For saying that, you may go. The demon has left your daughter." So she went home, found the child lying on the bed, and the demon was gone. And that, my brothers and sisters, is the reading of God's word for today. Jesus does his thing. Jesus does his thing. He enters the house, didn't want anyone else to take notice. But there's no escape. People always notice Jesus. People always want Jesus to do his thing. Jesus can hardly ever be kept from being noticed. My first question for you today, have you noticed Jesus yet today? Are you looking for him? A woman whose little daughter had an unclean spirit or demon, something like that, and it took her over. And then our text says next, it said, a woman having heard all about Jesus. That's what the New Revised Standard Version says. It says, a woman having heard all about Jesus, she lived way up north of Jerusalem. How many of you know word travels fast? Don't need texting, don't need a cell phone. All you need is a whole bunch of people talking and people traveling back and forth, word can spread, can it? Good news travels what? Fast. A woman having heard all about Jesus. It was out. No secret anymore. News of this Jesus, he was healing folks. People, they were touching him and being healed. They were bringing him on mats. They were lowering from a roof. People just walking up, touching the fringe of his garment. Boom! What kind of superheroes movie would they make out of that? Why not for her little girl? Why not? Why not for us? She came and fell down at his feet. I want to share Matthew's account. It's a little bit different, so you can do a little comparative, and we'll move forward with both of them. A Canaanite woman from the vicinity came to him, crying out, "Lord, Son of David, have mercy on me. My daughter is demon-possessed and suffering terribly." And Jesus did not answer a word. Jesus just laying back, seeing what's going to happen. So his disciples came to him and urged him, "Send her away, for she keeps crying out after us." Oh, those people who bother us. Just send them on their way. We don't want to be bothered. He answered, I'm going to share this next line two different ways. You take the one you think it, the correct reading or interpretation is. Same words. He answered, I was sent only to the lost sheep of Israel. Then I want to read it kind of like maybe a Jewish person might read it in my head. Was I sent only to the lost sheep of Israel? Don't get confused at this, because Jesus is for everyone. Jesus was pointing out that he first came to reveal himself to the Jews. His round one was to give the Jews the opportunity to get who he was first. God wanted the Jews to present the message of salvation to the world, and then this woman. There's faith in this mother. There's hope in who she sees. There are stories about this Jesus, and she believes. There's no giving up in this woman, no giving up in this mother. There is no giving up on this chance with Jesus. If I share nothing else with you today that sticks, I hope this takeaway of the morning sticks and that you hold on to it and you never let go. Let there be no giving up on Jesus. One more time. Let there be no giving up on Jesus. For Jesus can calm everything. And Jesus shows up to do his thing. God has not given us a spirit of fear, but of power and love and of a sound mind. And she believed. Tell everyone who's discouraged, be strong and don't be afraid. God is coming to rescue, to your rescue. All she did was reach out and claim it. What do you claim today? There's faith in this manner, hoping who she sees, stories about this Jesus. She believes there's no giving up on this chance with Jesus. Next, our text says this. The woman came and knelt before him. "Lord, help me," she said. You ever been on your knees literally or figuratively and said, "Lord, help me"? Kneeling before God. Not a bad thing to do when you want God to hear you or be near to you. What is it that you can kneel before God today and share with Him? Ask of Him and believe. He replied, "It's not right to take the children's bread and toss it to the dogs." "Yes, it is, Lord," she said. "Even the dogs eat the crumbs that fall from the master's table." Someone took my clock from down there on the first row. I could just preach for a long time, can't I? You know what it means when a preacher takes off his watch? Lays it up here? Nothing. She knew, this lady's mother, she knew. She knew that the Jews didn't see her as an equal. She was a dog to them, not one of them, an un-Jew, a dog. She was not one of the chosen children, but love never gives up. And she was willing because she believed in Jesus. And she was gladly going to take the crumbs that fell off of his table. Even a crumb from the table of Jesus is to meet enough to meet any need we have. Monetary, emotional, spiritual. She knew she needed Jesus to get through what she was going through. She needed Jesus front and center. She would take whatever she could from him and knew, here it is, she knew it'd be enough. She never gave up. She never gave up on Jesus to do the things that Jesus can do. And when that happened, she moved beyond her boundaries. Love moved the boundaries. Faith moved the boundaries. Healing was moving boundaries. Church, Jesus moves beyond our boundaries. For your boundaries are not His. She believed. I believe. We believe. Jesus, do your thing. Then Jesus said to her, and I love this, y'all. I love this. "Woman, you have great faith." I can imagine. Remember a minute ago, he was just kind of sitting back, seeing what would happen. Then he's re-engaged into everything. He sees what happened. He listens to her. He's watched the disciples. He's seen everything taking place. And he finally speaks up and he says, "Woman, you have great faith." Not just faith, not a little faith, not some faith, not the faith of a mustard seed. Not just faith when things are going okay, but faith when life is hard. Sometimes life gets hard, doesn't it? Verse 28, then Jesus said to her, "Woman, you have great faith." Church, parents, and grandparents, This is one of those times, and this is one of those seasons. And we are a church of great faith. And we ask Jesus to come and do his thing amongst us. A time when great faith is needed, for greater is he who is in me than he who is in the world. Then Jesus said, let it be as you wish. Your request is granted, and your daughter was healed at that moment. Just right before this story, Jesus is teaching about inner purity. He's with the Pharisees and he's having a conversation about what and food and eating, all this kind of stuff. And then Jesus does it again. Jesus says, the people honor me with their lips, but their hearts are far from me. They worship me in vain. Their teachings are merely human rules. Jesus wants us to honor him with our hearts and our lips and with our great faith. Altogether. Jesus is looking for us to be a people, not just of faith and not just of great faith, but of great faith who tell it and do it, who say it and act like it. At the end of that passage, Jesus says something like this when he concludes. He said, it's not the things that go in us that'll get us. It's the things that come out of us that will get us. And in this season, do not let fear come out of us. For fear diminishes great faith. Faith must come out of us in a way that honors Jesus even when life is difficult. Her great faith was saying, Lord, what harm will come from allowing me to just sit underneath the table and take some scraps? And he said to her, for this saying, go your way. The demon has already gone out of your daughter. Jesus does what Jesus does. Jesus is doing his thing. Jesus restores. Jesus is in the restoration business. Jesus moves beyond boundaries and does what Jesus does. He restores. What do you need restored today? May we move beyond our boundaries of doubt and fear and call upon our Lord and Savior who has no boundaries and ask him, heal the brokenhearted, take fear from among us. Call us to the garden so that we may stay awake and pray with you. To walk by great faith and to keep our trust in him. For God gave us a spirit not of fear, but of power and love, a sound mind and self-control. We are a people of great faith. Let us pray. Our God, we thank you for your word and how it speaks to us. There are times that we are shaken, but we are not moved from our great faith. For nothing can separate us from the love of God through Christ Jesus, our Lord. This mother, oh God, what a model she is for us. So much so that Jesus just compliments her. Oh God, may you see in us, hear from us. May we about being a people that display our great faith in you always. Thank you for having us by the hand. Thank you for letting us take someone else by the other. As we all move forward together. For we are a people of great faith. And it's Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Our hymn of commitment is number 426. Let's stand and sing verses 1 and 2 of Victory in Jesus. God, we thank you for your word, how it speaks to us, how it comforts us, how it challenges us, how it lifts us up, how it moves us beyond our boundaries. We are a people of great faith. May we act that way. May we share that way. And may we love that way. And it's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
May the grace of Christ.